Well, Dan, I'm sorry for my awkwardness, or at least for Tom's awkwardness. I was just flowing with the moment there. Dan, how are you doing today?
I am excellent. How are you?
I'm very good. Thanks for being on the show, sir. Dan, tell our listeners a little bit about yourself.
So I have a small boutique SEO consulting company called Evolving SEO. We're near Boston in Worcester, Massachusetts. My wife and I, we run the company together. She kind of handles the business, the finances, all that stuff. And I kind of run the consulting side of things, talk to clients. And we've got a couple of employees. And
Before you go any further, you actually run your business with your wife, huh?
We do, yeah. So I started the business by myself in about 2010. She was going back to business school at that time. When she graduated and then started working with me in the company and kind of took over the finances and the QuickBooks and everything like that.
Yep.
She logged in for the first time and she was like, "What did you do to all of this? Everything was a mess. Like nothing was tagged correctly. Like right. I probably didn't set up all the accounts right or anything." So it's really great because she provides something that I certainly am not good at and don't really want to do myself, which is all the finances, the bookkeeping and everything like that.
Right.
So I can kind of focus on running the consulting side of things.
Oh my gosh.
That's worked out very well. We've got a couple of employees and the biggest really line in the sand for the types of companies that we do not work with is local SEO situations. So nobody that's trying to like geo-target customers, right. But contrary to that, we'll work with anybody from e-commerce to startups to B2B, B2C, SaaS companies, really everything and anything that's got kind of a national or global audience.
Gotcha. I'm still stuck on the fact that you're able to work with your wife in there because I've heard scenario after scenario where husband and wife, it doesn't really work well. And I've been towing that line for a very long time.
I hope your wife doesn't listen to the show.
I guarantee she doesn't.
You're digging right now.
Well, I'm actually trying to make my case because if she catches Dan.
Let's get the engineer redoing this and you should say, that sounds like a fantastic setup. You know, there's nothing more I'd love than to spend more time with my wife during the day.
I love you, honey.
I could tell you one little secret of how it works is we have an office in the city of Worcester, Mass, but I basically go into the office and she works at home. So we're basically separate and we have some meetings and stuff. But
I see.
But that's one of the secrets, right? Is we're not physically working in the same room all the time.
Or she'd tear your throat out, right?
Probably.
Oh man. That's awesome. Well, I mean, that's very cool to know. And I mean, again, I mean, it's unique to be able to see that type of, relationship inside of business and kudos for you. I guess
I'll tell you one little interesting anecdote actually is so the other half of my story is I started Experts on the Wire. It's an SEO / marketing podcast.
Right.
Talk about that a little bit. But she was actually a factor as to why I have a podcast at all. So let's reverse the clock back to basically about exactly a year ago. I was in discussions with our first employee, Anthony, because we wanted to start doing some kind of show in the SEO world.
Right.
So I didn't know if it was going to be a video show or just transcribed interviews or like audio or what it was going to be. We spent a couple weeks planning it. I lined up my first guest, Marie Haynes, to be on the show. This is no joke. Like 2 minutes before our scheduled interview, I didn't even know how I was going to record the show. So I was like Googling like how to record a Skype phone call a minute before our conversation was supposed to happen. And I found Skype call recorder for $30, downloaded it, installed it, and did the call, boom, and away we went, and recorded the audio only because I didn't have enough room on my hard drive for like, a whole video file. But anyways, the reason why I decided to do an audio recording really was because the night before, my wife and I were having a discussion and she said, she had just heard me do a consulting call on the phone. She said, "You know what? You're really great on the phone. Not so good in person with people." And I went, "Oh, I thought this was going to be like just a compliment, right?"
Wow.
Of course she had a throw. But her point was,
at that point in time, Dan, you would have had the ability to fire your employee if that person was so disrespectful, but no.
Yeah.
You've got the wife there.
Yeah, I can't fire in that situation. But the point was is she thought I was strongest in communication in an audio format and a call format. So she didn't know it, but she had actually just sort of planted the seed in my mind to say, okay, I think the show that we're about to do tomorrow and record the first thing with Marie, it's going to be a podcast. So it was basically that night before, because of that conversation, that Experts in the Wire became a podcast and not a video show or anything else.
Very cool. Very cool. Well, you know, you, your firm and our firms have a lot of similarities. Oddly enough, we're both in SEO. We're both in podcasting. I really wanted to talk to you a little bit about SEO first and talk about some of the key concepts that are moving and continually to trend inside of SEO. Well, before anything else, actually, we had an interview with Rennell Smith last week, and he as well as you are our Moz associates. Quick question: what all does that entail, and how has he impacted your career path?
It's a great question.
Not he. How has that? That was odd. How has that impacted your career path?
I think Moz really needs to create a page. I'm going to tell him after we hang up. I've had more people ask me, what the heck is a Moz associate? Like, nobody has any idea. They really need to do a better job at explaining what this is. But essentially, for me, I'm in their Q&A for a couple hours a week or even just a month answering questions. Mm-hmm. They'll assign them to me sometimes. We're also able to post on their main blog without having to go through the UMoz process. We can sometimes speak at conferences, like I spoke 3 or 4 years ago at the Mozcation Portsmouth.
Right.
And we get a free ticket to MozCon if we, you know, want to pay for the flight and the hotel and everything. So that's kind of a nice perk as well. It's been great being a Moz associate because, you know, it's a nice badge of, you know, credibility. I can put in my email signature on my website and everything like that. But it's also been great too because it gives you sort of an open door to network or communicate or seek advice from anybody at Moz, from Rand all the way down to, you know, other people that are, you know, they're like the video producer there. Like, I could reach out and just ask if I needed a video production tip. So it's been really nice in that sense and just very cool to be part of what's a very welcoming community in the SEO space.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, and community is the key word when describing Moz. And we did, we had Rand on here, and it was just amazing hearing his understanding, his emotion and his connection. Pardon me. To, you know, what has been a very important set of decisions that he took very, very personally on jettisoning some of the additional areas that Moz had moved into. Boy, that was a solid interview. It was intense. So
I always thought, and see, this explains it. I always thought that Moz associate just had to bring Rand coffee. This whole time,
or mustache wax.
Mustache wax. Well, no, we should tell Dan your story about this mustache.
Yeah, Dan. When we had Rand on the show, Aaron, you know the story with the mustache. He's growing it out, and he hopes to shave it off soon. Aaron asked him once he shaved it off if he could mail it to us.
He literally asked him that. It was the most disturbing episode ever. We literally all just went. Oh.
Everybody started looking at their devices. Very, very uncomfortable.
Well, because if you back up, that begs the assumption that it comes off in one solid, like.
Yeah. I know.
No, he wanted like a Ziploc. That way he could put just a little in his wallet.
Swipe of the razor.
Rand, mail me some pieces of yourself. Wow. See, creepy. I just doubled down there. Okay. Hey, SEO keyword research. Yes. Let's jump over there. Talk to me about your thoughts in keyword research and opportunity gaps.
Yeah, keyword research, this is one of those places where I think a lot of people are still not looking or putting in the effort to like find the actual opportunity out there. So yeah, we're talking about keyword research in context of how do I identify content that I can publish that will then rank organically and drive traffic.
Right.
And I'm also even talking about keyword research and publishing content that doesn't always require links or link building to that content. Mm-hmm. In many cases, I've identified topics for clients that they've published on sites that have maybe a domain authority of 39 fairly competitive spaces, 40 domain authority, but they rank number 1, 2, or 3 because we're finding these opportunities and I can speak to a few of them. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, when they think about keyword research and trying to find opportunity. They fire up Moz or they fire up SEMrush. They try to depend upon the keyword difficulty scores that the tools give you. No tool can really replace your brain and your practice and your understanding of how Google works and how rankings might work and how they might choose what content to rank, right, how what content might satisfy users.
Right.
And a lot of it, so much of it is qualitative assessment that you have to make on the content that you can't rely on a tool to do for you. So many people say, build quality content, which obviously we all hate hearing that because we know quality is just such an empty word.
A buzzword. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, when you really break it down, quality spreads across many things, such as relevance or such as like a recency or how expertise was the author that wrote that content, or yes, the quality of that content, but we can even break that down. So what I encourage people to do and what we do at Evolving SEO is we'll use tools and keywordtool.io and Moz Keyword Explorer and SEMrush to find the topics, to find the keywords, but then we're going to every SERP and clicking on the content to see, qualitatively speaking, what does this content lack? So, for example, the biggest gap that I see is in relevance,
right,
meaning what the searcher has searched and what is returning in the SERP is not matching in terms of relevance. And the example I give sometimes is I was doing a presentation once and we were looking for examples of this. And one of them I found was people were searching cat attacking feet, right? Because I guess apparently some people have problems with a cat will actually be attacking your feet, right? All of the
results. Not when you take their tail off.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. What was that? Just went violent.
Yeah, dark.
Jeez, dark. That was dark.
Keep on going. Keep on going.
He owns two dogs.
And I have two cats, one without a tail. Just saying. There's full context right there.
Wow.
As funny as the topic is, yeah, cat attacking feet. All of the results ranking, for example, at that time, were not about cats attacking your feet or solutions for that specifically, as funny as this is.
Right.
They were all just solutions around cat attacking you, like in general, like a general cat attacking something.
Right.
So it's a funny example, but that's like a nuance in relevance where you can create that content around that longer tail thing and answer the thing more specifically than anybody has answered before.
Right.
And I often like to think of like, can you create the content literally nobody has created before on the web? Like, can you find such a gap where you're finding that topic that nobody has answered? So like maybe somebody answered it on Quora or Yahoo Questions in 2009,
right,
but nobody's answered it in a content Google environment. So that's a huge gap in opportunity. Another one is recency. Mm-hmm. And in a lot of industries, you can get away with evergreen content, right? You can get away with content published in 2010, and it can rank for years.
Right.
But in a lot of industries like marketing, if you publish content even 2014, you're out of date in a year or two. So if you're doing your content research and you see all those old dates in the SERPs, or you click on the content and you see all the old comments from 2008, you know there's a gap there as far as recency because nobody has addressed this topic.
Absolutely.
And one example I like to give is software reviews. How many software, like how annoying is it to go click on a software review and to see screenshots of it from 2013?
Absolutely.
That are out of date because the UI has changed and all this stuff has changed. So I want to encourage people to put in a little bit of the extra work and try to find those opportunity gaps by actually clicking on the search results.
And you're talking about getting in and really being the consumer on behalf of your client, and not just do research from a dashboard or a tool set that's giving you volumes of keywords and just putting together an entire sitemap that just matches that. You have to understand customer intent, and that's what you're talking about, is really getting into that buyer's journey, like we talked about, understanding where that consumer is at the different levels of awareness, all the way to decision making of purchase, right? And what the phraseology is that people are and looking for, what niche concepts, and not only just the terms, but also the experience that they are having looking at those search engine result pages. Because I was just doing this yesterday as I was looking for a particular tool, and I know I look for tools all the time, but this one was for a very good reason.
Mm-hmm.
All right,
sure.
So, but I was looking for these, and I was looking for these a particular type of tool, and all the results that I was seeing were from 2014, 2015. And that showed me, and now I don't see, I mean, I'm in this industry, but I know consumers are savvy and they're paying attention to the dates of these documents and on top of the domains and the URLs that they're coming from. And if they're seeing stuff that's stale out there, I mean, my first experience was to pull back. I'm in the wrong phrase because I'm looking for a competitive piece of software, right? And this is just showing me some stuff that literally nobody's taking the time to be competitive inside of. Now, I mean, that's a stretch to think that your consumer is thinking in that space, but they do see dates and they do see freshness. And anybody who's wanting a review page and the thing hasn't been updated for years, you know, that's not a space. But that does show you the gap that you could exploit right there. Absolutely.
I got to tell you another one that we find with Martech is so Google has an expansive help system, right? Mm-hmm. But if you actually go there and look at their help files, they very rarely have videos or images.
Yeah, that's right.
Within their help files. And terrible. The reason is because they would be changing them every time they update their stuff. And so we'll often publish a great how-to article and have step-by-step instructions, and we jump above Google in results about their own product. And so, you know, it's the same thing. Those gaps, we love those gaps. That's a great tip.
Yep.
Yeah, another thing people really need to understand and look at is like, people don't quite grasp how to tell when they can rank, or like looking at their site and knowing, okay, my domain authority is 40. If you're looking, if you're analyzing a SERP, search engine result page, I still think some people might know what I'm saying when I say that. If you look at a SERP and there's even two or three low domain authority sites already ranking there,
right,
mixed in with all, you know, DAs, 80s, 90s, 100s, whatever, you could still possibly rank there if those lower DA ranking sites are still not good in quality or relevance. So
that's right.
I think actually by the fact that they are there, that's showing you even more of a reason why you could potentially rank. Google likes a diverse result, right? Like they like niche sites and they like big, giant authority sites like Huffington Post and New York Times and whatnot. So
that's
another angle to look at this from, is how can you help make Google's results more diverse in a sense? So maybe even if you see all 10 results are from these big name websites, maybe they would love a more niche website to come in and rank for something. So a report that I love that's in SEMrush is, if you sense that there might be a topic gap for the particular content that you're trying to write, if you go to SEMrush and you plug in a big name website like entrepreneur.com, mm-hmm, go to the pages report and run a filter on your topic. And then if they're using dates in the URL, 2014, 2010, just plug in an old year into mm-hmm the filter.
Yeah.
And what you can often unearth is a list of pages of content that target your topic, but that are still ranking, but they're old, right? They're from 2010, if that's the date you put in your filter. So this is sort of leveraging the power of the tool to do that heavy lifting, to find these opportunities in bulk. And then you click on the keywords link and it takes you to the report. It shows you all the keywords that topic is ranking for.
Yep.
And you can go in, basically create a piece of content better than they have, than they created in 2010.
It's a fantastic tool, and you're giving insight into maybe some functionality that people aren't aware of. And there's a lot of new things inside of SEMrush. The dashboard, the projects that they have now are rich, and literally with the alert system that they have going on, it's really evolving to a fantastic tool. But the level of filtering and control of focus that you have in that keyword data research, it's not just about the volumes of searches. It's not about those fathead terms. Literally, it's giving you such a rich wealth of topography. And this is what you're really talking about, is understanding context, understanding what's happening on the search engine result page, because your consumer is absolutely looking at all of this. And you need to be able to understand where you're really competing. Don't stand off and just run numbers and keywords and think you've got an SEO plan. You've got to get in the trenches and be that consumer, right?
Absolutely.
Oh, fantastic. Well, in the same space, let me ask you, on the same lines of SEO, the overlap, the intersection of branding and advertising with SEO focus. Give me some thoughts there.
Yeah, absolutely. So in 2013, I'm sure everyone experienced this, I started getting a lot of messages, emails, mm-hmm. because people were hit with Penguin. An example I always like to give is somebody from bowling.com reached out to me. What was happening to, so many of the people messaging me had EMDs or exact match domains. So right. What was happening was, as I'm sure a lot of people know, the Penguin algorithm was designed to target over optimization. So one factor of that course was over optimized anchor text. Anchor text that was your commercial keyword,
right,
pointing to the page that had the URL with that commercial keyword. External anchor text and sometimes internal anchor text as well. And what I saw was so many of these EMDs were writing me because they were getting hit with Penguin because their domain name is their keyword. Bowling is the keyword bowling, right? So in some of these cases, I felt that they were being maybe a little unfairly hit. But then what I noticed or what I saw out there was a site like Moz, for example, who I know all the listeners are familiar with.
Right.
They have these things, Whiteboard Friday, Rand Fishkin is the name of the founder. They have MozCon, which is an event. They, you know, other companies like 37 Signals, they have a name for their blog. Staples even, they have this stupid thing called the Easy Button. Nobody else has the Easy Button. So
right.
When I saw all of this, it led me to write a post in 2013 where I came up with this thing called proprietary keywords, which I can't say apparently. Proprietary keywords. Also, for short, I called it prop words, okay. Proprietary keywords. And I was just describing what I saw out there, which was sites that were not getting hit by Penguin. They had these real world things like entities, like people, places, a book, an event, the name of their office, Googleplex, right? That's a proprietary keyword.
Yep.
All of the companies that had this stuff, like what would people do? They would go to Google, they would type Whiteboard Friday, they would click on Moz's result, and they would go to Moz.com. Or maybe SEOMoz.org at that time. And to me, that really sent a strong signal to Google, not unlike brand search volume as well, that your site is something that people care about and they proactively they have it in their memory and they're looking for your site on your own. And not only your brand, but unique proprietary content that only you have. It could even be the name of an article that you wrote. Is a prop word, a proprietary keyword. So
absolutely.
That's one area that always has fascinated me. And I want to kind of unearth this and talk about this more potentially in the future, because it was something I published in 2013 and haven't talked about it a lot since then. I would love a client out there to actually embark on a case study where we create something that's a prop word for them and then study the results of that. But the tie-in to the name of it, prop word, is a prop word actually. So when I was writing this post, I was looking for something that I could use in the title or come up with, coin a term, right? So coining a term is another type of prop word as well. Mm-hmm. Like think about growth hacking, right? Like that term didn't exist before Sean Ellis created it. Now right. It's his prop word.
Right.
But, or inbound marketing is another example I like to use. So I want to talk about this more, but prop word is a prop word as well. So that was a clever little, what I thought hopefully was a clever little tie in there.
Some sort of inception that we're in now.
Yes, exactly. We are in the matrix. But the other example, something more recent that I wrote about the overlap of branding, advertising, and SEO.
Right.
It's just in brands' homepage meta descriptions. If you go to Google and you type Macy's right now, you're going to see one of the most hideously written, I don't even know if it's written or like if it's just pulling the text from the page, but like Macy's, for example, has not done a good job of crafting a great meta description that mm-hmm. literally millions of people a month are seeing when they go to Google and they type Macy's or any, you know, it's probably like 10 million people are seeing this meta description.
Wow.
You factor in all the ways that homepage is showing up in the search results. Yet Macy's or these big brands will spend millions of dollars in the name of branding and advertising and messaging to try to get us to think or feel a certain way about their company. If they're not going to take the extra half an hour or hour to like actually write 156 characters that speak to us in a way that resonates in the same way they're trying to do with advertising or branding or messaging. And I was inspired by this idea. I was listening to a podcast called Building Your Brand Story with Donald Miller.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
On iTunes. And he talks about making your consumer the hero, right? Using the hero's journey in all of your marketing places, not just when you write an article, not mm-hmm. when you just do a podcast, but like even down to like the hero image and the heading on your homepage. And when I heard this, I said, why can't we apply this to the meta description, right? So the post I wrote, I went and I found 15 brands, like I think some of them were like maybe Uber, like all the common ones that are actually using a great meta description that make their customer the hero, right? They speak to the customer in the second person. They use words like your, mm-hmm. and like they speak to your emotions. So they basically, like when I analyzed this, they all broke it down into the three things that Donald Miller talked about on his podcast. When you're trying to make your customer the hero, you show them the problem. Mm-hmm. You show empathy. You show them that you understand their problem they're going through.
Absolutely.
You highlight the solution, that the solution is on that URL that you want them to click. And then you show them what the outcome is going to be of that solution. So yep. you can actually do that in 156 characters like I showed in my post. Is that really SEO? I don't know. I mean, it's not, it's in the meta description, but it's not impacting your rankings.
Right.
But it's something that an SEO would care about. But it's also something that I would think as a brand you would care about as well, because millions of people potentially are seeing this messaging in the search results.
Absolutely. And I think you're striking a chord into something that we would hope that SEOs respect and aspire to achieve. They are marketers. They're not just tacticians and technicians. They are marketers, and they hold a particular role inside of convincing and converting. Or we'll give a shout out to our Jay Bayer fans, right? To be able to give them, give the consumers a roadmap of what value you're going to find at that website. They SEOs have to don the hat of persuasion marketing. I mean, this is the buyer's journey, the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and everything's around this. Understanding, empathizing with the user's plight, right? And then getting into a solution, offering up a solution into that decision. I mean, there's three stages, there's five stages, seven stages, whatever they break it down to, but it's exactly that. It's connecting emotionally with a consumer, and you can have dry websites that can be incredibly large websites, but they're not connecting with their customers at the point of, you know, the contextual knowledge of the SERP. So, I mean, it's a very important role that the SEOs still have in this space, because they're the technical purveyors of this marketing message, right?
And I think I'm just going to read two examples, because I know as a podcast listener myself, I love to actually hear the examples. So Macy's, the one that I'm saying is a bad meta description, this is literally their meta description. When you go to Google, you type Macy's, it says Macy's. Free shipping at Macy's.com. Macy's has the latest fashion brands on women's and men's clothing, accessories, jewelry, beauty, shoes, and home, .. It's terrible. Like, it's more like, it doesn't tell me anything like about how I should feel or like why I should care about Macy's as a company.
Right.
Which is pretty accurate with Macy's.
Yeah. So yeah, some of these are just the problem with the
customer
brand, right?
Customer service over there.
But one example I love is ModCloth, for example. So I didn't even know what ModCloth was until I went to SEMrush. I put Anthropology in there to look for other companies that might be doing cool things.
Right.
And I found ModCloth, and it actually, I'm going to read their title and description. So their title is ModCloth Women's Vintage Style Fashion Clothing and Decor. Great. Got my keywords. I know exactly what they sell.
Sure.
The meta description starts with, feel confident, look stunning, and be the best you.
Nice.
That is awesome, right?
I want to be the best me I can.
I'm going to go buy a dress from ModCloth.
Yeah. If I was in the market for a dress, it would tell me how I would feel watching that, right? But then it continues. Shop ModCloth for fashionable vintage style must-haves, including clothing, swimwear, decor, shoes, and more. So great. There's my products, my keywords. But it begins with that feel confident, look stunning, and be the best you. Now, I have a sense as a user like how I might feel potentially, or you know what I aspire to if I were to shop there. So I think that's one of many of the 15 examples I have in my post there. But
we tell people it's a call to action, right? I mean, you wouldn't put that Macy's explanation on an advertisement and put it in a magazine, you know?
Exactly. And that's, would you see that on a billboard?
Yeah.
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 No, it's a beautiful thing. There's so much inside of SEO. You truly have an insight, and I want to do respect to the other side of the equation. But that, I mean, we would certainly love to have you back around and talk in depth about these concepts of SEO, because it is more than the technical side of things anymore. I mean, there is such a marketing focus that needs to happen there we find it as a kind of a mission on our end. Because we have come from the SEO world to really put together the roadmap for digital marketing focus and education for these SEOs. Got to get them out from behind their cloistered areas and get them understanding their role in the space. But I want to switch channels to podcasting if we could real quick.
Absolutely.
Well, what have you learned in starting now? Your podcast is a well-known podcast, and you've been doing it for a year, and you got some great numbers, got some great visibility. Experts on the Wire is your podcast, and they're talking predominantly SEO. What have you learned in starting your own podcast?
Oh goodness, where do I begin with this? I think one of the biggest things, and it's something that you learn, any entrepreneur or business person or marketer even learns this and then you forget, right? So every time you start a new thing, there's always this desire at the beginning, or this feeling like you should try to define what it is
right
at the beginning. When you're just sitting by yourself, you know, in your office trying to come up with this thing with a whiteboard. But what I've learned again, and what I've learned many times through whatever band I played in or whatever marketing endeavor I did, or whatever business endeavor I took upon, you really don't know what that thing is until you have an audience, until you've had an audience for a while.
Right.
And they're giving that communication, that feedback back to you. It becomes that nice feedback loop. And so I think one of the biggest things that I've relearned sort of in doing this process is that, yeah, as cliche as it sounds, is just start something, right? You really need to just start and don't stop. Unless it's really terrible, right? But like, it's going to take time for you to figure out what that thing is that you've started and what it means to your audience and to hopefully the greater world that you're trying to reach.
Right.
That's kind of the big philosophical thing I've learned. I think to bring it down tactically for a moment, I've had to practice writing a lot of titles and descriptions and trying to go back to each episode and pull out and think to myself, what's the lead here, right? What's the story? What's the value add that happened in this discussion? How can I convey that as a marketer, mm-hmm. as a copywriter,
right.
in the title, in the description, in my intro, in my show, I record the intro after we do the interview. So
sure.
I give myself a chance to try to set it up a little bit better. So I think as a marketer, having a show like this is really giving me the chance to practice just that. And it's oftentimes taking other people's points of view and their content.
Right.
Because people come on the show and they don't talk about things that I would talk about. They talk about like their expertise and like their mm-hmm. thing that they're involved with. So it's giving me the chance to try to dissect that and distill it into, like I said, a title, a description they're going to see in Twitter or in LinkedIn, or like even a meta description like we were talking about a minute ago. So.
Sure.
I think those two things have been interesting. I mean, there's a lot more I could talk about with podcasting, but those are the first two things that come to mind.
Well, very cool. What kind of tips do you have? I mean, when somebody wants to start their own podcast?
Yeah, I think it depends on what type of show you want to begin. So I'm going to speak towards my style of show because it's what I know. It's what I've been doing. So I can give theoretical tips if somebody wants to start the next Radio Lab, and I do have some audio production experience. So like, but that's theoretical, right? If you want to start the style of show that I run,
right.
which is akin to like a Mixer G, or, you know, I aspire to be at like, you know, Ira Glass, you know, like a very interview style show.
Yeah. Absolutely.
The number one thing is research. Like research. That's like the biggest thing that it creates two things that happen. Number one is when I'm well researched to a guest, when that guest comes on my show, it impresses them. So like, hopefully like the day that I get Gary Vaynerchuk maybe on my show,
right?
That's my chance to impress him as a researcher and somebody that understands the questions to ask him.
Yep.
that nobody has asked him before or asked him. Nobody has asked him in that way.
That's very, very, very important right there. Absolutely. Yes. Being able to also have contextual knowledge of the different shows he's been on, right?
Yes.
And be able to ask the question that was not asked.
Yes. So for somebody wanting to do a research show where they interview marketers or business, like that, or an interview show, the research is the backbone of your show, absolutely, number one. And number two is that, of course, goes into your listeners. That impresses your listeners. Like, I will listen to Andrew Warner interview somebody that's been interviewed a million times, mm-hmm, because I know Andrew is going to get something out of them that nobody has gotten out of that person before. And I've heard it time and time again. They put in their research, right, look at numbers. When I have a guest on my show, I've got SEMrush tabs open. I've got archive.org tabs open. I've got Open Site Explorer tabs open. Like, I'm looking at their sites as if I'm looking at them to maybe be a client of mine, right? Like, mm-hmm, that's the depth that I want to go into, to look at the links they have, to look at how they got their traffic. So yep. I don't want it just to be surface level stuff. We really want to go in deep with it.
Oh, that's very cool. Yeah. And that's very, very important. Don't go into it lightly. Don't go into it without having these key focal points there. Otherwise, yes, you're going to learn along the way, because you're not going to be having the value appreciated by customers or by, yes, listeners. So in from an amplification standpoint, from a broadcast standpoint, what social media channels do you use to promote your show?
Yeah, this one's interesting. So the show's been on the air about 10 months, 11 months, and most of that time I didn't put a ton of effort into proactive promotion, right?
Okay.
I leveraged sort of my own audience, my existing audiences, the audiences of the people that I interviewed. So organically speaking, you know, just tweeting it, sharing it on LinkedIn, emailing it to a few people, there hasn't been a ton of proactive promotion. But now we're shifting gears a little bit, where in 2017, now, like, a lot of it was, I just wanted to get good at interviewing and at running a show to feel like I had a good, solid portfolio of shows that I actually believed in promoting.
Yep.
Like, if you had asked me to, like, promote my show at episode 10, and I'm sure maybe you can relate, right? Think back to your first couple episodes. You're over 200 now, so you've got, right, me way beat. But, you know, I'm at 55 or something. I didn't want to share my show very heavily because I knew we were just getting started and, right, practicing and learning and, like, trying to make the show better. But now, like, I want everybody to hear the last couple interviews I did with Saul Orwell, with Ross Hudgens, because, right, like, I think if you listen to a lot of the SEO content out there, a lot of the, you know, even reading wise, like, I think it's some strong stuff that they brought to the table that we were able to engage in conversation. So now I'm not that shy at all about sharing it, but,
yep,
I definitely was not aggressive in sharing the first batch of episodes.
No, I can appreciate that. Neither will we.
And remember back in the days when you had all the technical difficulties?
And actually, I didn't quite answer your question. Sorry to interrupt you there.
Go ahead, sir.
Being on other podcasts, yep, is like basically my number one strategy for 2017, because I had the chance to attend a workshop that Roman Mars gave. Roman Mars hosts 99% Invisible. They've got the Radiotopia podcast, huge podcasting space. I had the chance to ask him what gave 99% Invisible the biggest exposure.
Right.
And it was when they were on Radiolab, when they were featured on Radio, like, overnight, they were a huge success by being on Radiolab. So, like, the number one thing that I've heard and know anecdotally, and I'm starting to experience a little, is being on other podcasts.
Yep.
Is a great way, obviously, to get people interested in your podcast.
So basically, he's using us.
Yeah. Well, I always like that too. I always tell people the same thing. You know, I think there's this competitiveness that's unnecessary. Mm-hmm. Like, that people are going to gravitate towards the people that they're attracted to, no matter what, right?
Right.
And so I love that podcasters are often on each other's shows, because you're introducing knowledge to your audience that you weren't before. So they're getting exposure to new ideas and everything else. So you're increasing the value to your audience. And then two is, someone in your audience may actually like that show more than yours, and go listen to that one.
What?
Go listen to that one too, or in replacement of. Like that's not a bad thing. That's
you're
a good
actually
thing.
Doing a service to your consumers.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I mean. It's value and it's authentic. You know, it's not saying we want you all to keep here and stay here huddled. You know, forget that.
And I think if you listen to our podcasts, are very different. Yours, you've got multi people sitting around. Like me, it's just one person interviewing somebody else. You cover the news. We don't cover any news at all. Mm-hmm. It was just a decision that I made early on, and you happen to cover the news. That's a huge value add on this show. And you know, actually, like as somebody in the SEO world, I would tune into this show to catch the news. If you don't have the chance, like if you're not following Barry or like whatever it is, so. I think that's a big difference in our show.
And that's the sound clip we're going to use for advertising right there. Very good. So lessons learned. It's always, you know, we always experience bobbles and fumbles along the way, right? Lessons learned for those aspiring podcasters, because collectively, I know we've got a bunch of them. So what have you experienced that you could share with your listeners and our listeners?
I think another thing that I did early on was, and this isn't really a lesson learned, but it's a tip I can give all your listeners. I took a look at all of the reviews in the podcast space for a marketing podcast, business podcast, entrepreneur podcast. Right. This is a Tim Ferriss trick, by the way. I looked at all of the negative reviews of existing podcasts. This is before I started mine. To find out what were the complaints, what did people not like about other podcasts that were out there, and then try to avoid making those mistakes. So tons of, and you've done a great job of this, right? Look at you're in a fancy studio with like nice mics. So like so many people complain about bad audio quality. Mm-hmm. And so that I knew that was kind of my ace in my pocket because I have music production experience. I had a nice mic. I know how to do post-production. So like that was something I knew I was going to get. But like another thing that I saw in negative reviews was people didn't like shows that took too long to build up to like the thing, the interview or like whatever it is.
Right.
If the show was not positioned that way. Right. So like if you're positioning your show as like an interview show and you're not setting it up and like getting people to expect something else coming before that, like you do the news and that's great.
Right.
People get agitated and they get impatient, right? I found like 4 to 5 minutes was too long for me for my show to like do an intro or like whatever it was until we got to the actual interview. So I think you really need to do your research, again, back to research, into what are some of the things that people are not liking about existing podcasts. If you are starting a podcast, or if you're just underway or like thinking about starting one. It's a great, like it's already consumer research that's out there for you.
Absolutely.
What are some of the podcasts you're listening to?
I have some on my phone, but as I'm bringing it up, I can go by memory. So Mixergy, I mentioned, I love Andrew Warner's style of interviewing. I find when you listen to a lot of pure interview style podcasts, it's not a nice mix of like story and data or like story and results or like how to tips, but he mixes those together very well. So I appreciate his podcast for that.
Edge of the web.
I listen.
Edge of the web. Yeah, that's not what I was going for. Just saying there could be an ego stroke in there.
I was saving the best for last.
Yeah, whatever.
Remember that tip about promotion. You want this promoted, right?
But if that was a serious question, so James Altucher's show.
Yeah, okay.
I like his show. I like the Tim Ferriss show.
Yeah.
I'd like Art of Charm once in a while, 99% Invisible that I mentioned.
Oh, very cool.
Anybody liking health-related stuff, Bulletproof Radio is pretty good. Mixergy, Fresh Air is nice. I like the Startup Podcast. Yep. How I Built This is a pretty nice new one. I mentioned Building a Story Brand with Donald Miller. I like Art of Manliness is pretty good sometimes. Like Noah Kagan's got a nice new podcast out too.
Noah's a good guy.
Cool. And of course, The Edge of the Web.
There you go.
Thank you so much.
When do you have time for Netflix? Jeez.
The truth.
Maybe let's podcast and chill.
light some candles.
Yeah.
a little Dan Shure mood music.
Okay, stop. You're going creepy again.
Hey, Dan, to wrap up, and we really appreciate your time today. What bugs you about the industry that you're in right now?
Yeah, it's funny. I know you asked me this question. I completely forgot what my answer was. Do you have my answer there?
Yeah. Well, you said the industry people don't bother you. What bothers you is that if you're a creative at heart who happens to do SEO, people outside of SEO look at you with a stigma.
Mm.
Yes.
Interesting.
Yes. Thank you for reminding me because I did want to talk about this. Yeah. It's interesting because I have SEO is the first word in all my profiles, right? Twitter, LinkedIn.
Yep.
Obviously, my domain name, so my email address. So
yep.
I always get this as I'm branching out into like podcasting, and maybe you've experienced this as well. If you're a creative person, like I'm a musician, right? Mm-hmm. I like photography. Like I'm very much a creative person at heart. Mm-hmm. But when people see that label of SEO, but they're in the creative space or they're in the content space or they're, you know, they're NPR people, like I know for sure that they're looking at you with that stigma that, oh, you do SEO, like you're not a creator. Like it's kind of like this box that you're put in.
Right.
One thing that I like is sort of the fight of trying to like get out of that to like be both of those things, mm-hmm. because I think it's entirely possible. I mean, look at what you're doing here, right? You're creating content, you're a media company,
right?
You're publishing stuff, but you're also doing SEO. And it does bother me a little that just because I have SEO on my thing there, right? Like I have a little bit harder of a time earning the trust or the respect or the attention of people that are creatives mm-hmm. or creative people mm-hmm. because they look at SEO as this like tactic or this, you know, marketing, like even just marketing some of those people. It was interesting. I mentioned talking to Roman Mars when I asked him about how do you promote your podcast? The only answer he had was, well, we were on Radiolab. That was it. Like he didn't say, like they don't run ads to them. Like they don't do marketing to their, and a marketer there in me is sitting thinking like, well, what if you just did a little bit of mark? Like you could probably like do some damage if you actually marketed your stuff. But a lot of people have like a pride or like this thing where like they don't want to market. Like they just want to do their art and their content. And I find that a little, you know, saddening sometimes, but also that is the thing that's frustrating as well.
I feel like SEO guys, I shouldn't say guys, but I feel like the SEO industry also kind of brought it on themselves.
They did.
You know, I mean, we had a pretty good collapse there. And so by the time we got people to understand the value of SEO, they thought everybody was just, it was just gaming the system. Mm-hmm. And so, so by then we had the stigma. And so, you know, the irony is, you know, we do SEO as well.
Right.
I don't know that I have it on any of my stuff.
Well, it became a bit Nigerian Prince, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
The Canadian lottery ticket for a while.
Yeah, absolutely. So
yeah, because companies got burned.
Yeah,
and on top of that, there is a perspective of left brain, right brain in this industry of marketing, is that you have to be visual to be creative. Well, that's so rudimentary. Being a creative SEO means that you have a strategy concept.
Right.
And very creative at some point in time, and you have the technical prowess to be able to execute something from a coding standpoint, right?
But vice versa, I'd say that some of the highest ranking sites are the most creative, right?
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, especially today, there is so much noise around that you have to be creative in order to differentiate yourself, your message, you know, just even a meta description, like you were saying, Dan. I mean, you have to be creative in order to differentiate yourself and get ranked. So to me, it's, you know, what could, you know, forced creativity where you have to rank a customer in accounting or something, you know, at the top of their field, you know, what takes more creativity than that? You know,
apologies to all the accountants out there.
No, I don't apologize.
Well, it goes back to Dan's.
They
messed up my taxes.
Well, it goes back to Dan's brilliant tip on how he uses SEMrush too, right? Yeah. You hear about all this there's so much content out there. What could I possibly write?
Yeah.
And his tip was brilliant on solving that problem.
Right.
So, you're absolutely right that there is a stigma. But I do think that business at large and you know the community of digital marketers, I mean, SEO is not dead. SEO is
evolving.
Is evolving. There it is. Boy, that was
I love that word.
It is actually evolving into something much more of a vantage point and understanding of strategy. Okay. Thus, you know, comes strategy before anything else. You need to be observing things. You need to be able to hypothesize from the scientific side of things, right?
You did like 3-4 syllabus words today.
Syllable.
There you go. Wow. syllabus. I need a syllabus for your syllables
there
today.
There's a glossary that comes along with this show.
You said topography uh-huh. today?
Contextual. Wow.
Contextual.
Phraseology, too.
Wow.
Yeah, see?
You are a buzzword maniac.
I am.
Edge of the web, Harvard.
Speaking of things that were buzzing, you drove a VW that used vegetable oil for 2 years.
Yes.
How?
That was my unknown fact.
Yes.
lot of French fries.
It's a lot of French fries. How did you come up with that idea?
Yeah, it was just something. This was like 2005 or 6 or so. I was driving a ton as a gigging musician.
Yep.
And I was spending so much money on gas that I had heard that if you got a diesel that they go for, like, they get like 50 miles per gallon, right?
Right.
And so I did some research. I found a VW Golf that ran on diesel, bought it. And a friend said to me, oh, you're going to run that on vegetable oil? And I hadn't heard of that. I went home, looked it up, and I saw that people were using this company out near Ryan in Massachusetts called Grease Car, I think. Mm-hmm. I don't even know if they're still around, but they basically made these kits. They were $800. You buy the kit,
yep.
You're a mechanic, or if you're like you're a DIY mechanic, you can install it yourself, and you can run the car on filtered used vegetable oil, right? So like I would actually use the oil from all the restaurants I was gigging at, and I would like finish my gig, and then I would go down to the kitchen and grab the oil, and I would bring it to this like setup that I had built at my dad's studio.
Yeah,
basically filter it through these like sock filters, and you get the cleaner oil, and you pour it in a second tank that was in the trunk. Huh. And then you would start the car as soon as the thermometer hit the middle. You flip a switch. You're on the veggie oil. You can drive like that until like maybe a minute before you're going to stop.
Wow.
You flip the switch the other way, and it purges all the lines. And then it flushes diesel back through the system. And I did that for about 2 years. It was probably over 100,000 miles I drove on veggie oil.
I think I was driving behind him one time. I stopped at Wendy's like 4 times.
Yeah. He was making me hungry. Yeah.
My car smelled great.
Hell yeah.
The car was vegan, right? It was very healthy.
Well, Dan, is there anything that we can promote for you?
Well, obviously, as I mentioned, I'd love for people to check out Experts in the Wire, the podcast.
Yep.
And I'm going to mention you guys on my show and send some listeners your way as well.
Oh, fantastic.
And check out Edge of the Web. As we discover, we have the same initials in our show, EOTW, which also stands for End of the World.
Exactly. Yeah, we discover that on the B-roll. Boy,
or excitement on Trump's world. I'm just
sorry. You need to go back to end with that.
Sorry.
All right.
I'm very responsive on Twitter. So if your listeners want to say hi or connect with me, at Dan_SHURE on Twitter. I would love for people to say hello and chat.
Very cool. Well, we certainly appreciate your time today and great insights into SEO and podcasting. And I think we can count on you all as a friend of the show. We'll certainly watch and listen accordingly. And we'll connect with you down the road here and let us know if there's anything that you need from us. And we'll certainly see you in the interwebs there, right?
Absolutely. And I will do the same. Let me know if there's anything I can do.
Fantastic. All right. Well, this is Dan Shure here, Experts on the Wire. And be sure to check out his iTunes and his website as well, Evolving SEO. Certainly a quality podcaster and a quality SEO. We appreciate your time today, sir. And we'll talk to you real soon.
Thank you.
Take care.